Heavenly Father, thank you for all the more opportunity to preach your word. Please, Lord, open our hearts, our minds, and let us rejoice in the presence of your Holy Spirit. And help me to deliver this message at this moment of high emotions within my heart. We praise you, Lord, for everything that you have done. Jesus is special. Brothers and sisters, the title of the message for this morning is How to be Thankful in All Things. How to be thankful in all things. It comes from the Gospel of Luke, chapter 17, verses 11 to 19, that you just heard. This Gospel teaches us profound lessons, and I am going to preach on the subject of thankfulness to God. Thankfulness to God. What was going on back then when Jesus healed those lepers? Jesus was on the way to Jerusalem to give himself as a sacrifice for our salvation and for their salvation. And the encounters that he had along the way revealed, number one, who Jesus was, number two, revealed his power and his love, and number three, he revealed something else, the nature of the kingdom that he would establish over here on earth. And we believers are the ones who represents God's kingdom on earth until the time when Jesus will come back to rescue us. Now, Jesus met those 10 lepers when he passed along between Samaria, which was a territory that he would find enemies, and the other territory, which was Galilee. So when he entered a village, the lepers lifted up their voices, saying, Jesus, have mercy on us. Jesus, have mercy on us. As you know, leprosy attacks the body. It leaves sores, missing fingers and toes, and destroys the flesh of the people who are affected by that kind of disease. However, it causes much more than physical damages. People considered lepers, the ones who were affected by that disease, they were considered unclean, so that they should be apart from all people. They would not be able to come into town. They should be out there as a kind of people, rejected people. But the Lord came to bring healing to them and to save the sick. This is why Jesus came, to establish his kingdom, to save the ones who are sick, so that he healed them all. But what was the outcome of that healing? Among the 10 lepers healed, only one came to give thanks to the Lord, came back to give thanks. Only one. Think about that. Among 10 people, only one came to give thanks. The stranger was the one who came back, the one from Samaria. A Samaritan man, Samaritan leper, came back to give thanks. Because the Samaritan highly appreciated what Jesus had done for him, he was very thankful to Jesus. But there is something else behind the scenes. When the Samaritan man came back to Jesus, the Lord asked him, where are the other nine? Where are the other nine who were killed? And Jesus' question leads me to another question. Were not those nine men thankful to God, thankful to Jesus, because they were also healed? And the second question, did they believe in Jesus, or because being Jews, they took that healing for granted and they did not see how great was Jesus to bring healing to them? Now, the deep lesson comes up when Jesus told the Samaritan why he got more than physical healing. Why the one who came back got much more than physical healing. I found two other translations which clarify the real meaning of the Greek word about healing. Eugene Peterson translates that specific verse, and he does that explaining. Jesus said, "Your faith has healed and saved you. Your faith has healed and saved you." And that Greek word can be translated in different ways. Number one, healed. Number two, made well. And number three, saved. And King James Version also brings us a better translation when it says, "Your faith has made you whole." Your faith has made you whole. Therefore, one thing is clear when we take a look at different translations. There is more at the stake than mere healing. Every time that Jesus comes into our lives, whatever the situation is, to bring healing, if it is the case of physical healing, he is able to provide us much more than physical healing. Two words come together when we talk about faith. The first word is believing, and the second word is seeing. Taken together, they orient us the way that Jesus instructs his followers back then and nowadays, that faith is not only a matter of believing, but also a matter of seeing what Jesus does for us. And I have many reasons to be thankful to God. Lately, I learned to be thankful to God. A few years ago, I learned how to be thankful to God, not only asking things. We usually come to God when we are in trouble to ask for something. But I learned that he is able to give me much more than just fixing what is wrong. That is all about his love. And then what happens? The reason I am thankful to the Lord for everything, for the good things and for the bad things, which appear to be bad, but in reality they are not bad things. The reason why I learned to be thankful to the Lord is that when we are thankful to him, what happens is that we are testing our faith. We are testing our faith because those things that come from his promises, what he promised us, is not just a physical healing. It's not just good things, but what He promised us is what we really need, which is His love. And when we believe who Jesus is, like that only one man who came to give thanks, is because we truly believe that what we are not seeing yet is going to happen because of His love and because of His faithfulness. So His promises are going to be always firm and effective to lead us to the right path. So, as we go back to the lepers who were healed, one, however, saw something different. He saw what Jesus was doing. He noticed what Jesus was able to do, and let what happened to sink in, and it made all the difference for his life. Because that man saw what had happened, that leper had something for which to be thankful. Because he saw what had happened, that leper recognized Jesus, recognized His reign, recognized His power, and why He came. He came to save him. And because that leper saw what had happened, he changed his direction. Jesus had told them to go to the priest because of the formal law, but that specific man, that specific one who had his heart full of thankfulness, instead of going straight to the priest, he came back. He returned, first of all, to give thanks to Jesus Christ for what he had done. The emotional pain of a leper must have been even worse than the physical pain. Sometimes our physical pain is not all that we are suffering. Sometimes our emotional pain, the pain which is within our souls, is what really puts us down. This is why Jesus is worried with our soul, not only with our physical being. They were removed from their family, they were set apart, they were not allowed to be with people, but they were removed not only from their families, but also from the community. They were isolated. Think about that. How many people are isolated out there in need of help? In need not only to learn who Jesus is, but also to receive that kind of love that only Jesus is able to provide. Think about that. What they needed the most was to be saved and to be back to their families, to be back to their community, totally recovered. And that was the mindset of people which is still going on in this world. How many people they are set apart because they are labeled as unclean people? Think about that. Think about what was going on and what is still going on in our world nowadays. Jesus wants to give us much more than physical healing. He wants to save us. He really wants to save us. And this gospel, true story, which was a true story, serves as an invitation to believers to recognize that what we believe and what we see is what makes our lives better. That is what makes our lives better. When we believe in what we cannot see yet, but we believe that God's promises are effective, then we are going to see how beneficial those promises are to us all. So I come up with a few questions for our reflection, so that we might digest the deep of that gospel. Each time we read that gospel, something else comes into our minds. I have preached on that passage already many times, but each time I read it, each time I digest the difference of attitude between the one who came back to give thanks and the other nine, something new comes to my mind. So a few questions for our reflection. In face of struggles, what do we see? Do we see danger or opportunity? Think about that. Every time you are facing struggles, think, deeply think about that. Is that a new opportunity for us to grow in our faith, or just to face that as a dangerous thing? In face of human needs, do we see demand or the opportunity to change our minds? Every time we reflect on our human needs, and we were talking about that this morning, every time we think about our needs, every time we think about our limitations, what comes up is that reflection about believing or doubting. And James was clear when we read that passage this morning. A double-minded man is the one who bounces all the time. But when we are walking by faith, although we cannot see what is going to take place yet, but we believe that God's plans for us are much better than our own plans, then we are able to give thanks. And in the presence of a stranger, like that situation of the Samaritan leper, do we see a potential enemy or who can walk along with us and who can help us somehow to let us know what the truth is all about? The Samaritans, as I said, they were considered enemies of the Jew. But Jesus wanted the other ones, who were Jews, to learn from the Samaritan what that lesson was all about. My friends, if we trust in Jesus as our Lord and Savior, not only our helper, and look to the future, as we are looking to the future right now, do we see fearful uncertainty or an open horizon? How we answer those questions depends on our faith and what we have seen in our close relationship with the Lord. So do not fear, just trust and give thanks. Now let us go back to the attitude of the only leper who came back to say thank you to the Lord. His kind of thankfulness was motivated by faith. And our thankfulness has to be motivated by our faith. So believing and seeing are those two words which work out for the best together. So I want to leave you this word. How about the attitude of the nine others? were also killed and did not come back. So let us be thankful to God, even amidst difficult circumstances. God tells us, love me despite of diseases. Obey me despite of lack of resources. Praise me in all worst of circumstances. This is Jesus, the one who loves us so much. He will give you and give me the opportunity to be thankful when nothing about our circumstances motivates us to think about good things. Therefore, this week, not only this week, try to do that along the journey. Be sure to be thankful for everything. And be sure to gather everyone up, not only within the congregation, but within your families, for a real prayer of thankfulness. That is going to change our lives. And I have experienced that. And that is why I'm thankful to the Lord for the opportunity and privilege I had to serve over here for these last 18 months. And I served here as His servant above all. And I praise the Lord for that. And I give thanks to Him and to you for everything that we have seen along this journey together. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, I give you thanks for the privilege to serve here as your servant. All I want, Lord, is to be your servant. All I want is to give thanks because I have seen your power in my life. I have seen your power within my family. I have seen your power within the churches that I have served. And I praise you for that. Please, Lord, let us keep walking together by faith and united in you, Lord Jesus. You have prayed that prayer before you ascended into heaven, praying for you, praying for our disciples, and praying for the ones who would believe. So you remember us still back then when you were ready to go back to be with the Father. And you remember us, the believers, talking about our unity when you said, be one with me as I am one with the Father. And we thank you, Lord, for that word. Let us keep united, even being close or distant from this congregation right now. But let your love keep flowing within our hearts. And then we look forward for the challenges as an opportunity to look at a kind of open horizon, not fearing, but trusting that you are the head of the church. And this is your church, and we are your church. So we ask you, Lord, bless us all. In Jesus' name. Amen?
Amen.
Okay. Thank you very much. Let us sing this.